This program is proudly brought to you by the ABPA, Gold Pin, AMF and Bowling Balls Australia.
Good evening, everybody. Welcome to the Tenpin Bowling Show's coverage of the 2008 Australian Open. My name's Stephen Rawson, and alongside Michael Tran. Good evening, Mike.
Good evening, Steve.
How are you, mate?
Yeah, very well, thank you. Great to be here covering the latest action of Tenpin around Australia. Tonight, we're covering the conclusion of the 2008 Australian Open. Last week, we covered the first match of the final between Matt Riley and George Fallingos. And as we go down to the lanes, covering the second game, and George comes into the second game with an 8-pin lead.
Yeah, that's right, Mike, and very even level peggings after the first game. Both bowlers 210 or 202, not bowling, you know, out of the blocks, great stuff, but, you know, they just did enough, struggled a little bit. Anyone's game.
Yeah, for sure. I 100% agree. Like you said, not bowling the fantastic stuff that we're used to seeing these guys, but just doing enough on these conditions. Both bowlers only leaving one open frame, and I suppose just with this last game, it's a matter of being the cleanest.
That's right. And George, you know, he's just finding the pocket. This one didn't look too bad, just a little bit light, just couldn't quite get the carry, and I think just a little bit of luck's going to come down to it as well.
Yeah, it looked like George really tried to reef that one going down. Probably a little bit fast and missed the break point.
That's right. And I think we could start seeing a little bit of, you know, the lanes just changing a little bit. You know, I think we'll see some ball changes early on into game number two. And whoever can adjust the best and, like you said, keep clean, keep sparing, is going to take this out, I think.
Yeah, good spare there by George, going cross lane to cover the 6-pin.
And there's going to, you know, a lot of nerves for these bowlers. You can see there, you know, George, they're really, really tense. This is Australian Open, Mike. It's the biggest one in the Australian bowling calendar. Everyone wants this one.
Yeah, absolutely. Matt Riley has won it here once before. But wouldn't you love to have another one?
Absolutely. And, of course, bowling really well against Brenton, and a nice first game here against George. Oh, almost got the messenger there, sticking a temp in.
Not quite getting the carry on that one. He looks like he threw it a little bit wide. The ball did recover for him, though, so perhaps a good sign.
No, it looked like a very good shot. A little bit unlucky not to pick up the strike there, but should go back down and knock down the 10-pin. Uses his plastic right across the lane. Solid as you like.
Yeah, these bowlers get a lot of practice covering those corner pins, the 7 and the 10, which are the least likely to go down if any happen to stay up. But no, they get a lot of practice at shooting those corner pins. And like any professional bowler, should be able to cover them with ease.
Both bowlers starting their first frames off with spares. I think it's going to come right down to the wire. Both bowlers, you know, top class, bowling very well this tournament. Matt just maybe looking just that little bit more solid. You can see on that shot, just bury that right in the pocket.
Yeah, so we'll have a look at the pin action replay there, and look at that, that's crunched at 1-3 pocket.
Very solid stuff, and George just maybe on a bit of a back foot here. He just needs to keep with Matt. Here, of course, George, though, with the 8-pin lead going into this game, so he's got a little bit of breathing room. Just a little bit.
Yeah, definitely a little bit, but look, George just needs to throw a good shot here, keep making good shots. It's not quite the strikeout scenario that we all dread.
That's right, and this shot looks really good. Oh, he's stuck the 7-pin.
Oh, another 7-pin for the left-hander.
Looked like a good shot. Just came in nicely from here, just on the replay. Just seemed like it skidded just that little bit on him and just didn't quite get the finish on it.
Yeah, just a touch. Definitely a good shot, though. If I was him, I'd definitely keep playing there. Maybe just to make a marginal change with his setup on the feet, perhaps. A little bit to the left might get you hooking the ball into the pocket just that fraction sooner.
I mean, on paper, this lane condition doesn't look like the toughest, but it punishes you if you're not consistent on it.
Yeah, absolutely. With the patterns they lay down for these prestigious events, it definitely will punish you if you're within a board or two outside of your mark.
Yeah.
And I suppose that's what we all as bowlers should be aiming to do. You know, hit our mark consistently. If not hitting the mark, getting as close as you can to it. But look, these bowlers have been bowling on these patterns for quite some time, and they know how to handle them. George's third shot there, not quite getting to the pocket as he would have hoped.
No, just like we pointed out in that last one, just seems to skid just that little bit too much. His ball just needs to get into that roll just a little bit earlier, I feel.
Mm. No, I agree with that one. But he's just nicked the head pin there, and he's left himself quite a difficult split.
But I'm sure if anyone's going to bounce back and sort this out, it'd be George. Been around the bowling scene a long time, well respected, and it won't take him long to make a change, I don't think.
Yeah, number one Australian ranked bowler for many a year.
Yeah.
But look, I think he was just going for the pin count there. Like we said before, it's not quite the panic merchant situation that we all don't like to be in. But look, just get the pin count and move on from there.
That's right. And Matt will take the lead here with a double if he can bury this one in. Oh no, wow. A 7-10 split from a pocket ball. Don't you just hate seeing that? Just watch this on the replay. How does this...
That's an awful break. The head pin going off to the sideboard, just missing the 7 and then ducking behind the 10.
That's disgusting.
That's terrible.
Yeah, he smacks the 10 pin down a few extra Ks on that shot, I believe. He's still in disbelief. We're in disbelief. I just cannot believe that strike shot, that first ball just looked perfect. He's laughing about it now, but tell you what, I wouldn't be laughing too long. That could come back and bite him there.
But I'll tell you what, sometimes all you can do is laugh. But no, double would have set him up nicely there, but still takes a 3-pin lead in this match.
Catching him up slowly, but...
But look, the best thing he can do here is just say, look, he hit a pocket. Let's just go back and do it again and hope not to catch the same nasty break.
Yeah, I mean, that messenger could have taken a 7 and 10 out instead. They both stay. He shot it, just not quite happy with it. He seems like he might have came out of the top of it a bit too early.
Yeah, looks like he turned the wrist on that one. But hit the pocket light. Maybe, I don't quite think he was trying to over-correct what he did last time, because he really didn't do anything wrong last time. But, just got a bit light in that shot. Hopefully cover up the 2-4-8.
That's right. And just, you know, with his last, you know, in game number one, he did finish that off really well. He had a turkey and finished off the spare in the 10th. I just felt, and with his first two frames, Matt was looking really solid, but these last two, I think, might have just lost a little bit of confidence here. He's picked up the spare there, but, you know, George has a bit of an opening now, even after leaving the third frame open with a split. Matt's not running away with this at all.
No, well, he's been making good shots, with the exception of that last one, of course. He is on 48, carrying on a spare. George just needs to close this one here, and we're back to a single frame deficit.
One of these bowlers, who's going to be the first to make a move? And I tell you what, it might be George after that shot. A little bit light in the pocket, maybe, but carries a wall shot beautifully. Gets beautiful carrying his shot. Just love how he stays down. Good follow through. Finds the pocket. 10 falling a little bit late, but that's a good shot.
Yeah, I still don't think he's confident or completely comfortable with that last shot. It looked like he lofted it off the foul line. That one looked a lot smoother. Getting the pocket,
not quite
the
carry.
Yeah, leaving a 6-pin there. But if we had a look at that last shot, which we're not going to get another replay of, unfortunately, he did loft it quite a long way over the foul line. That shot was solid onto the lane, but looked like it just read the mid lane a bit better and bit up on it.
He might have made an adjustment there and just finishing that little bit harder. He looks very tense. I mean, we've seen him in qualifying. The last week's show, we saw some qualifying. He looked really relaxed, you know, out there having a bit of fun. This one, he just seems to he's not confident, I think. He's just can't quite find his shot. Maybe a little bit of frustration creeping into his game. But he's still got the lead. Matt really needs to get moving here, because George, if he can start firing, it's going to be hard to catch.
Well, Matt with a strike here comes in 5 pins. So that's how close this match is.
And this looks good. Stay down that nicely, and he's buried it.
Wow.
Great shot there from Matt Riley.
Yeah, high flush is all I can say about that one. But
watch your balance here at the line. Sorry, mate, just watch this. This is great balance.
Yeah, fantastic balance at the line. The toe's pointing in the direction that the ball is taking. Look at that. It's cut straight past the 9, but yeah, a bit of pin action helps him carry that.
That was a great shot. George looks a little bit worried. Those Matt's rolling the ball fairly well. Matt just catches a few breaks here.
Well, we'll see. But no, George has been in this position many a time before. He knows
what
needs to be done.
Shot. What a shot. The crowd loving Matt. George, very popular bowler on the tour. And Matt also. And that's a great shot. Sort of 50-50 with a crowd, you know. It's hard to say. Everyone crowded around. Don't know which way it's going to go.
Yeah, it's a bit hard to pick at the moment. Matt just gaining the edge now, but look, I think with that last shot, he was just hoping for it not to go high.
That's right.
And lucky for him, it didn't. He's carried the double, the first double of the game. And we'll just see how George responds here.
Very deliberate approach, nice and slow. Good follow through on that. Just not quite finishing for him. Just skidding that a little bit too much. And finding the 1-2 pocket there, but just not the right angle of entry and just not finishing hard enough.
No, he's left the 3-5-6. I think a lot of it has to do with the way the ball's coming off his hands. The hand looks like it's in a different position. A couple of times he lets go here, and just getting a different reaction of the ball. His hand might come around it over the top sometimes, and it just won't get that mid-lane read.
And this can be a tricky spare sometimes, because you can sometimes chop it like that, but he's just had enough on it.
Take a deep breath, George.
Oh, wow. Just flipped it.
No, it didn't miss by much.
You can see here. Oh, wow.
That's great camera angle, isn't it? He's only just nicked that 5-pin.
One less coat of varnish in that pin, and that would have stuck, I think. Oh, a little break there for George. He can't afford to leave any open frames here. Moving on to the 7th frame, he's got to keep with Matt now. And very important couple of frames coming up for Matt as well.
Yeah, Matt working on the double, and George on the spare. So we'll see how he goes here.
Matt looks wide. Yeah, wash out wide. Shakes his head, not happy. Worst shot of the game there from George. Just a really bad time as well.
Yeah, it really didn't work for him, the ball there. Leaving the 1-2-4, 1-3-6-7.
The lefty, and he must hit the head pin here to the right, slide it across, knock out the 7. Sounds a lot of work, doesn't it? A very tricky spare.
It does, yeah, but this is pretty much the story at the moment. George needs a spare to stay in the game.
He must spare. It looks good. Oh, he slid it across beautifully. That's the sign of a quality bowler. Yep, just picks up with ease.
Yep, fantastic. He's gone across the lane. Bit of loft has helped him move the ball just that little bit earlier.
That's a great spell.
That one pin did not look like missing the 7 pin. It was a fantastic shot.
Well, George stays in the game. If Matt leaves an open or just a spare here in the 7th, George still right in this. But I tell you what, a strike here, which will give Matt Riley a turkey, would spell trouble for George. A bit of a fist pump there. The pressure is on George Frelingos.
Yeah, another good shot. This 1-3 pocket, he's got plenty of rotation on that ball, just cuts through the deck and clears everything.
That was finishing really hard.
Looks like he's finally found the right ball to bowl in these lanes. We noticed with last week's game, he was using a different ball, but something with a bit more cover.
Now has to hurry.
Oof. Oh, wow.
We saw against Brendan Davey, he had a lot of messengers there, particularly in that second game. Oh my god, he's had a few unlucky breaks this game. He had the 7-10 that stuck for him, and this time the 10 pin getting bombarded by scouts. But
I'll tell you what, if he could carry a little bit better than what he has done, and he's nailed the 7-10 once and missed the scout on 2 occasions. So goodness me, this could well nearly be a perfect game bar 1 frame, but not the spare taken care of. And Matt Riley almost has an assailable lead now.
That's right. George has to start striking, and Matt, one would have to think he might have to leave an open frame here coming up into the closing stages of this game.
Yeah, for sure. George has no option now but to strike, I think, in my view.
An open frame here would spell the end for George. Important shot. He has to get this one to stay alive.
Oh,
how did that 7-pin stick? That's just start of the game. We just said who's going to be the most consistent, pick up the spares, and who's just going to have that bit of luck.
And look at that great camera work right there.
He gets tapped there. 2, 3, 4, 5 wobbles. Nah. Looks like fairly new pins too, Mike. The flat bottoms on the pins just.
Yeah, perhaps they've taken a hell of a pounding this week, but
they have.
Not a strong enough kick off the wall. And George is left with a 7-pin to spare.
Oh, no.
And sends it into the trench. No, that's an open frame for George. He's left on 126 in the 8th. And one would say the Australian Open crown is going Matt Riley's way.
Yeah, I think that seven pin has spilt the end for George. Very unfortunate. I mean, that seven pin should have gone. He shouldn't have had to go back and spare it. But then some breaks. I mean, you know, look back to Matt's couple of frames, seven tens, ten pins as well. So it all evens out.
Yeah, each bowler's had their share of bad luck. You know, George washing out a couple of times and Matt leaving a 7-10 off the pocket. But it's the one who's been able to stay clean for the majority. There you go. There's
shot of the
good
game.
Strike.
Shot of the game, and just when it's too little too late, it just always seems to be the way that you pull out your best shot.
It's funny how you relax when you know the game's over.
That's right.
And, yeah, that was a flush pocket. It's, like you said, the best that that George has shot in this game, the better of the two. And George moving on to 126 on the strike.
Yeah, well, two strikes after nine frames, unfortunately, is not going to be enough to win an Australian Open title, especially when your opponent is drilling him in the pocket like that.
Oh, he's firing now.
Dare say, new Australian Open champion.
Yeah, well, for the second time.
But, exactly right.
Yeah, but had that that eighth frame been a strike, he'd be carrying on a five-bagger right now, and... you know, there's not much more you can do when your opponent's shooting like that. I just wonder if earlier George perhaps may have tried a different ball, maybe that might have put him back on his game. But, you know, he knows well within himself what the problem was.
That's right. It's easy to look back after the event, but you never know. And this shot looks good. Another 10-pin, wouldn't you know it? A little bit frustrated, but end of the day, the title is going to be his. He's done enough.
Yeah, absolutely. He's hit the better majority of pocket hits.
And, exactly right.
Yeah, I think in my belief that's what the match has come down to.
It's been more
who can hit the pocket,
pocket
most, who can carry the pocket most, but who can spare after you've left something after the pocket. And Matt Riley's done that to his full potential today.
That's right. Let's put the spotlight on him. I mean, against Brenton Davey, great composure. Just he blitzed him in the first game. Brenton really didn't stand a chance in the second, and just really done enough in the first game against George, kept with him, and this game he's just ran away in the late stages, bowled brilliantly. It's been great to watch, and a well-deserved champion.
Oh, no, that one just moving on up on him, but it doesn't matter. Matt shooting a 204, he's tally 406 over the two games, and Australian Open champion.
No, well-deserved, like we said, and just got to feel a little bit for George. Leaving another washout there, just didn't quite fire. First game, a good game, 210. But this one, you just see the frustration on his face. Knew he had a chance to take out another Australian Open Championship. Not to be. This looks good. Oh, pulls out a party trick for us at the end. Another washout spare.
There's that head pin that needed to kick over the seven a couple of frames back. But no, he knows it's all over. Last shot coming up.
But he can hold his head high, finishing second in the Australian Open. Is a great accomplishment. And there we have it, the gallery congratulating Matt Riley from New South Wales taking out the 2008 Australian Open for the second time, Mike.
Yeah, absolutely. He's performed fantastically over the whole tournament. You know, hasn't looked like missing the pocket a lot, but, you know, done enough. He's in that last match, shooting 202, 204 for a total of 406, and his opponent shooting 210, which was the better of the second game. But then shooting 165 to follow up, unfortunately, wasn't enough for George Lindos.
No, that's right. And Matt Riley, well deserved. Like we said, he just blitzed his opponents, did enough, got the strikes when he had to, found the pocket consistently, great sparing. Let's head to the presentation for a well-deserved victory.
What a wonderful finish to the 2008 Australian Open. Just a couple of thanks before we do the presentations. I'd like to thank the bowlers and spectators. It's great to see the bowlers turn up every year, and of course the spectators for supporting the show. I'd like to thank the staff of AMF Sunshine. We've got Rob and Bev behind the front counter. Also have Nolene and her team in the cafe, and Tim and his team down the back. I'd also like to thank the sponsors, AMF. Without sponsors for tournaments, we won't hold these events, so big thank you to AMF. I'd also like to thank Kelly at Total Bowling. Total Bowling, great supporter of Tenpin Bowling, so thank you again, Kelly. Also, I'd like to thank Ian Nichols from the TBA, the webmaster of the TBA, putting the scores up and updating it regularly. Thank you, Ian. I'd also like to thank the Tenpin Bowling Show for televising this event. It's great to see Tenpin Bowling on TV, so thank you again. Okay, we'll just go through the placings. In 10th place, we had Joel Lovegrove on 6389. 9th, we had James Bowles on 6459. 8th, we had Brandon Polachewski on 6509. 7th, we had Brett Smith on 6588. 6th, we had Jared Lean on 6594. In 5th place, we had Michael Little on 6599. 4th place, we had David Porto on 6695. Then we come to our stepladder match. The first match was between Matt Riley and Brenton Davey. And the winner was Matt Riley, 460, defeating Brenton Davey, 382. So third place went to Brenton Davey.
Thanks,
congratulations, Brenton.
Well done. Then we come to the second match, and that was between the winner of the first, Matt Riley, and George Frelingos. And the final results, Matt Riley, 406, defeated George Frelingos, 375. So second place went to George Frelingos. And the 2008 champion for the Australian Open was Matt Riley. Matt, I'd like to present you with the large cheque for $3,500. Just over this way, Matt. I'd like to put your hands together for the 2008 Australian Open champion.
And on the Tenpin Bowling Show, we're talking to Matt Riley, the 2008 Australian Open champion. Congratulations on your victory this week, Matt. How did you go about attacking the condition, given that the left-handers had tended to dominate for the most part?
Well, to start with, it was tight for the right-handers. We had a bit of an out-of-bounds, and then once they carried down, burnt up a bit on the edge, I was able to get in and get on it, which is what I like to do.
I noticed at one stage there, you also dragged out a sanded ball, a dull ball, and that gave you a little bit more swing area?
Yeah, the good thing about the resurgence, what I was using, is that it created a bit of a roll-up for me. It wasn't as snappy as the polish here, and it got into a roll earlier. So if I give it a bit of room, it would come back.
So in other words, ball was reading the mid lane a little bit earlier, and just gave a little more of an arc-type reaction.
Absolutely, absolutely.
This is your second Australian Open victory?
That's correct, yes. Been 8 years, so it's been a while coming.
Yes, I know what that's like. Yeah, we find that with the type of formats that we're using now on TV, that it can be difficult for the top seed to come in and perform straight away. Did you feel confident going into the final?
50-50, to be honest. I mean, I threw it good in the first match. I found a little bit in the middle, but then it was all over the place. Lanes transitioned very quickly, as they have done all weekend, and just trying to get, I guess, clean. Stay clean, don't leave splits, make your spares.
I see. Yeah, that's pretty much the way it was for most of the weekend, I guess. What's coming up next for Matt Riley?
For me, a bit of a break. I'm not bowling K&K. I won't be up there for that, but I will be back down here for the Melbourne International, I think, which is replacing the Melbourne Cup. So I'll be back down here for that. We have a few local events, so I'll be bowling in that, keeping busy.
Okay, and of recent times, your personal life has changed a little bit. You find, having got married and set up a home and what have you, has changed your attitude a little bit?
Yes, it has. Not that my beautiful wife won't let me bowl. It's just that family's first. And I love bowling, I have done all my life. But, my father passed a few months back, 18 months ago, and I've just been trying to support my mother. She's up and down a lot, and family's first. I mean, it's nice to come down here and bowl and see everybody, but, if it's family, it's family.
Absolutely, I couldn't agree more. Matt, congratulations again on your Australian Open victory, and thanks for talking to us on the Tenpin Bowling Show, mate.
Anytime. Well done. Thank you very much.
This program was proudly brought to you by the ABPA, Golpin, AMF and Bowling Balls Australia.